We're going to go ahead and get the program started now. I'm not going to set up a microphone. The microphone's with Dr. Van Ryan, but I wanted to introduce her very quickly to you. Dr. Sophie Van Ryan has a PhD in psychology and psychiatry. For the last 13 years, her line of research is focused on the cognitive and behavioral phenotype of individuals with 47XXY and 47XXX. She is currently appointed as an associate professor at the Department of Clinical Child and Adolescent Studies at Leiden University, where she manages a research lab for the study of developmental risks in children with those conditions. Using techniques from the field of neuroscience, such as neurocognition, MRI, eye tracking, and neurophysiological parameters, she has contributed to knowledge about the impact of having an extra X chromosome with over 40 publications. She's giving her first of two presentations here today. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Van Ryan.
Thank you for this introduction, and I'd like to thank the board and organization of ACCESS for having me here. It's for me a wonderful opportunity to meet families and other researchers, because it's also very inspiring for when doing research. So I would like to start with introducing myself just a little bit. I'm from Leiden University in the Netherlands. It's actually the oldest university in the Netherlands, and we have these wonderful buildings. But of course, we are situated in the more modern ones, as you know, always is. I'm at the Faculty of Social and Behavioral Sciences at the Department of Clinical Child and Adolescent Studies. So in our department, we have like 40 people, researchers working on neurodevelopmental disorders. And we have this specific team of researchers focusing on sex chromosome trisomies. So headed by Professor Hannah Swaap, we have a couple associate professors, and I have two PhD students working on research, and a clinician. So in terms of my background, it's in neuropsychology, and I also have a PhD in psychiatry, but I have to disclose that I don't do any clinical work myself, so I don't see families myself, only in a context of research. What I do is a lot of teaching. 60% of my time goes into teaching, and 40% of the time I spent on research. And although I always felt that it was a pity that I didn't get to spend so much time on research, now I have become to realize over the years that part is also very important, because now I have the chance, you know, to put all the findings that we have from research into the educational curriculum and train upcoming professionals, which is a really wonderful opportunity. I do collaborate with our outpatient clinic we have at Leiden University, where we also see a lot of families with children having extra X or Y chromosomes. So it's more in the terms of the collaboration that I'm involved in the clinical part too. So over the last 15 or 14 years or so, I've been working on doing research in this area, and we have seen about 60 adults with XXY over the course of the years, about 60 boys with XXY. This work is from the time where I was in Utrecht University, and at Leiden University I've seen 60 boys and girls with an extra X chromosome. So a lot of the work that I'll be presenting is about this cohort. So it's always been a mix of children that were prenatally followed up. So I visited all the academic centers in the Netherlands to ask the clinical geneticist to look in their computers to see who was diagnosed like 10 to 20 years ago. And I traced all the addresses and contacted the families, which was a lot of work. But we also have referred cases, which are referrals from other clinical departments. So having an extra X chromosome is thought to influence your development, your physical development, but also development of the brain and the related processes that are the brain is responsible for, the cognitive functions and the behavior. So from research we know that about 70% of all the studies is focused on the physical and the medical issues. So our research aims are to identify the strengths and difficulties in psychological development and understand kind of the underlying mechanisms of psychological development. So why do children develop emotional or behavioral difficulties if they do? And in our research, we really focus a lot on social functioning, because we feel that functioning in society has a lot to do with social adaptation to others in terms of relationships and family, friendships, in school, education, or in your job. We just think it's a huge part of our daily life and therefore important. So what is social behavior? It has to do with cooperating and collaborating, to share, to solve conflicts, to give comfort, to make friends, to deal with your own emotions and at the same time pay attention to the emotions and wishes and desires of others, and to understand the consequences of your behavior. And this is important in childhood as well as in adulthood. So we think that social ability is a good indicator of a person's resilience and capacity to meet demands of society. So what do we know about social functioning in sex chromosome trisomies? Well, there's a lot of research out there that have described an increased tendency or risk for to be timid or reserved, a little bit withdrawn, difficulties in social communication, or being socially immature or shy, social anxiety. So this is the work that has been out there, and I think it's really important in reviewing this work or thinking about social development that on the one side you have kind of the ability to navigate socially, but at the other side, you also have the need to have fulfilling social interactions. And it's really all also about the balance of those two. So what is social skills all about? Well, you have to see and look. You have to pay attention to social cues of others. You have to be able to label those cues, so understand the meaning of it, what it actually means. And you have to respond. So you have to kind of give an appropriate reaction to social cues. And this is really quite complex behaviors. A lot of us will also feel tired after parties, talking to other people all the time. And that is because it is complex in terms of you have to socially adapt right here, right now. You don't have a lot of time to reflect or think. And there's a lot of incoming information at the same time. And also cues can be very subtle. So it's quite a difficult task in daily life. And this social ability has to do with the processing of information in the brain. So I will now turn to that a little bit. So processing is done in the brain. There's a lot of incoming information. And then we need to do a lot of things. We need to oversee the situation. We need to concentrate on what is relevant and important. And filter. So some things are really not important. When I'm speaking here and someone is entering the room, I really have to ignore that in order to give a good presentation. So I have to filter information. I have to categorize into and label the information. I have to be able to memorize what I have seen and heard. I have to be able to switch and adjust all the time to other people. And I have to be able to monitor and control your emotions and your thoughts and behaviors. And you have to be able to empathize. So you have to the brain has to work really hard in order to give an adaptive response in a situation. So this is what we refer to as being the cognitive functions. And I will talk about that a little bit more. So we work from this brain behavior framework where you try to understand the kind of increased risk for emotional or behavioral or social problems and try to understand that from a profile of cognitive functions. And this is always an individual profile, but when studying groups of individuals, like the children with sex chromosome trisomies, we tend to see kind of pattern in these profiles, and I will talk about that. And of course, these are driven by how our brain has developed. So we've also been looking at brain architecture. And this is all driven, of course, by genetic makeup, but not alone, not by itself. Environmental factors are also very important. And I'll be talking about that a little bit more tomorrow. So understanding the underlying cognitive and brain mechanisms, I think it's important for a couple reasons, for knowing what the strengths and challenges of individuals are, to help explain why some individuals may have social, emotional, or behavioral problems, and knowing how to optimally support individuals based on that profile. And also identify targets for training and intervention and develop new interventions that maybe more optimally match the profile of strengths and challenges. So how do we do that? Well, these are the type of tools that we use in our research studies. We use questionnaires and interviews. We do a lot of cognitive testing, computerized test batteries. We do neuroimaging. We also use measures of heart rate and skin conductance to measure emotional arousal, for example. And we use eye tracking, even in the younger children, to see what individuals are looking at and what they attend to in their environment. So before going to some of the results from our study, I think it's also important to address how our group kind of compares to earlier work. So as an indication of overall level of functioning, here I present the average IQ scores that come from the earlier newborn screening studies on verbal IQ and on performance IQ and for the different conditions. And it's just to give you an idea that overall the average IQs are between 80 and 90 in those studies, in those newborn screening studies. These are studies from the 80s and 90s, huge populations that they were screening. So in our study, this is showing kind of the distribution of IQ scores. We see in the control group, we had a kind of a group of typically developing children without having any extra or Y X chromosomes. The average IQ is about 103, but you see a lot of variation ranging from 70 to 130. And we also see a lot of variation in the children with the extra X chromosome, but on average it's just a little shifted and the average IQ is 85. But we do have children with somewhat lower IQ and also children in the gifted range. So there's always variation, but on average this distribution is shifted and comparable to the earlier studies. So another thing that I would like to address before going into the details of the findings is the cognitive or behavioral profile different for boys and girls with an extra X chromosome? And this is just this is not a huge study that we did, but at least for the data that we collected, I've gone over all the kind of indicators and parameters that we collected data on and compared the boys and the girls. And here in green you will see the data from our control group, in pink from the girls with trisomy X, and in blue for the boys with an extra X. Just to illustrate that in our data set, all the scores for the boys and girls were quite comparable. I was not able to find any difference in average scores. This is the behavioral data on a kind of a variety of measures. This is for the cognitive data. This is for IQ. It was very similar. For language, the scores were also non-significant and similar. Cognitive control problems, so this refers to executive function, was also very similar. And in terms of social cognition, we also did not find any difference. So for this reason, I decided just to collapse the data because it was so similar, and I will be reporting on our findings for the groups pulled together. Because it's still a question if it's a comparable profile, and I do think we need a lot more studies just to make that clear. So our aim was to identify the percentage of children that are vulnerable. So what you would typically expect for a lot of traits is that the majority, just in the general population, that the majority of the individuals would have a kind of mean score, an average score. And a smaller number of individuals would have a kind of deviant score. This is one standard deviation, so it's a little bit shifted or a little bit different from average. And then you also have children or individuals that are at the end right here, meaning that they are more different. And this is, I think, what I would say is the clinical range. So you would typically see that only 2% of the individuals are in this range. 2% of the individuals in general are in this range. So I will now neurotypical. So I will now go back to the data on the children with an extra X chromosome and report on the percentage of children that are in this particular range. Okay, so first we asked the children themselves what they thought and what they worried about. So in the group of 60 children with an extra X, about 20%, almost 20% worried about their social skills, about 10% worried about their physical abilities, about 13% about their intellectual abilities, and about 13% about their appearance. So the majority did not have kind of significant worries. We also asked the children how they dealt with negative life events. So when anything kind of difficult happens in your life, how do you deal with that? That's something that we all have to deal with. And similar to other children, the children with an extra X chromosome apply coping strategies to regulate their emotions, the negative emotions. So they try to accept what happened, they try to concentrate on positive things, concentrate on planning what to do.
So you're saying that the kids with the extra X respond similarly?
Yeah. On these measures, yeah, yeah, and they try to reevaluate in a more positive way. However, the children with an extra X chromosome are more inclined to ruminate. So about 20% of the children have moderately to excessively rumination, which refers to a kind of tendency for thoughts and emotions to get stuck, to repetitively overthink your distress rather than focusing on solutions. So this is something they did more. And they also had this tendency for external attributions. About a quarter of the children had this moderately to excessively. So that's to identify the cause of your distress in external factors. So, for example, to hold kind of others responsible for your own distress.
Yeah. It was an accident.
So now turning to parental reports of behavioral and emotional problems, and this is based on the childhood behavior checklist, which stratifies all these different domains. So what I did was calculate the percentage of children having an average score, having a kind of mildly deviant score, and who are in the clinical range. And I came up with a kind of top three of areas of vulnerability. So here about 17% of the children score in the clinical range for social problems, but if you take that together with the mild range, it's the kind of number one area of vulnerability. And a shared second place is for thought problems and for withdrawal behavior. But also note that there are also there's a huge portion of the children that do not score in the clinical range on some on these different subdomains.
So is it 35.8% in the total, like in comparison to the 2% that we saw earlier?
Yeah, you would expect this to be 2% in a general population. Yeah, correct. Okay, and now turning to the risk for autism spectrum disorder symptoms. And what we did was conduct an interview that is typically used for diagnosing autism. It's the ADI interview, but we really focused on the symptoms and how many children met different categories of symptoms. This is an interview that is kind of retrospective, so it looks back to the age of 4 or 5. These are the percentages of children in the extra X group, and there are kind of three domains for the diagnostic criteria of autism. So in the domain of social interactions, about 2/3 of the children scored above cutoff on this question, on this interview. On the domain of communication, also 2/3, and about 1/3 scored above cutoff in terms of stereotype behaviors. But when we look at meeting all three domains, it was 19%. And this is not referring to a clinical diagnosis of autism. This is just looking at the symptoms, the behavioral symptoms. And when we look at clinical diagnosis, some other studies have, we see that, for example, the girls with trisomy X, they asked, Dorothy Bishop asked the parents about if there was any diagnosis in their family or in their child. She reported none of the children had. And for the boys, they're kind of variable percentages between 3% and 11%. So this is a kind of difference in terms of is there a risk for autism spectrum or not? And I think it may help in understanding the risk for this population to think in terms of more dimensional approach, because when we look at autism-like traits. This is the social responsiveness scale developed by Constantino. And this is taken from his paper. There's a lot of data, based on a lot of data. And these are the scores in the general population where you expect the average score to be around here. Well, in our data, we did find that the average score in the control group was about here. And then we found that the score of the children with the extra aches was about here. And we also had a group of children with autism, age matched, as a group of 60 children with idiopathic autism, and their score was about here. So when you look at the kind of classification in the manual of this questionnaire, the children with the extra aches are in the mild range on average, and then the children with ASD are in the clinical range. But you can imagine that some of the children may be kind of just below or just above this threshold. So that would create kind of variability when looking more at the clinical diagnosis. So I tend to think more in this dimensional approach, that there's this increased...
just miss the level of getting intervention.
Yeah. Okay. So now moving more towards understanding why social difficulties may occur in children with an extra X chromosome. And I use this theoretical model a lot. It's from Beauchamp Anderson, who did a nice work on putting all the research data together to understand what cognitive functions are important in general in social skills. So they identified attention executive skills and communication and socio-emotional skills. So this was really the starting point for us to see how this was like in the children with the extra X chromosome. So looking at attention and executive skills, and I will come back to what it actually means, about 70% of the children had an average score, so that's good, and about 30% of the children had a score in a clinical range, so where you expect it to be kind of 2% in the general population. So this refers to problems in inhibition, this the ability to control your impulses and to stop engaging in a behavior. It refers to shifting, that's the ability to move freely from one activity to another and to tolerate change and to alternate your attention. It refers to emotional control, so the ability to regulate your emotional responses appropriately. To initiate, so to begin activities, to generate ideas, to come up with problem-solving strategies. It also refers to working memory, so keeping information, to hold on to information for some time, to be able to make plans in a kind of sequential manner. To plan and organize, so the ability to set goals, to develop steps, or to grasp the main ideas and organize and understand the main points in written and verbal presentations. And also the organization of your material, so the ability to put order in your work, in your play, and to storage spaces, and to be able to monitor, so to assess your own performance and the ability to keep track of the effect of your own behavior on other people. So this is about 30% of the children had some sort of difficulty in any of these domains. So well, now we move on to more the kind of isolated domains, which we assessed with cognitive testing. So when we look at concentration and attention, so this is kind of assessing stable concentration over longer periods of time and focus on what's important and ignore kind of irrelevant things. That can be things that you see, but also things that you hear, or your own thoughts can also be distracting, or your own feelings can also be distracting. So here we also see that about 70% of the children have an average score, but 30% of the children have difficulties with this and are in the clinical range. And here I... Yes, these are the children with an extra X chromosome. So when I plot it over time, so this is about 20 minutes in blocks, in four blocks, we see that at the beginning they do well. The dotted line is the data from the extra X group, and these are the number of errors. So we see that in the beginning they do fine, but over time they start to make more errors. So for longer periods of time, it's especially more difficult. So then moving on to inhibition, that's kind of the brake on your behavior and thoughts and emotions and to control your impulses. About 3/4 of the children were in the average range, but about 1/4 of the children had score in a clinical range. And we also noted that we did some correlational testing that children with more inhibition problems were also the children that had reduced control over their behavior. So they had kind of more aggressive behaviors, but as a result of not being able to control your emotions and respond impulsively, and also they had more thought problems, so difficulties in organizing your thoughts. So So when looking at mental flexibility, so that's alternating your attention and moving from one plan to another, we noted that about 60% of the children were in the average range with their score, and about 40% of the children had a score in the clinical range. And we have done a study in adults a couple years ago where we learned that adults with XXY who had more mental flexibility problems were also the ones who had kind of more autistic-like traits and symptoms. So it does seem to have some importance for social adaptation. The adults were, I think the majority was on testosterone therapy, but it's a really relevant question to ask. But the group, we had a lot of young children coming in, but from the age of 14, most of them were using were on testosterone supplements. Yeah. And looking at working memory, so that's holding information on for, on to information for some time, about 80% of the children were in the average range, and about 20% of the children were in the clinical range. So this is not was not really the kind of area of highest vulnerability. We also looked at visual integration, so that's kind of getting the big picture of things and overseeing situations. About 70% of the children had a score in the average range, and 30% of the children were in the clinical range. And I included this to, just to show you, this is for the girls and the boys separately, but that it will, if we look at accuracy, we see that they're doing really good, so they get there. But if we look at reaction times, we see that they need more time to get there. We also looked at language production, so expressing your thoughts, and language understanding the verbal messages, and also the social use of language, so kind of knowing by intuition when it's your turn to talk in a telephone conversation. So within the XX, we see that about 40% of the children had either language production or language understanding difficulties, and about 30% had some difficulties in the social use of language. Yes?
Children that have a language difficulty in XXY, how many of these children would diagnose with some kind of hearing loss?
That's an interesting question, but we did screen for that. Yeah, would be very relevant to know.
I mean, yeah. I read that there's a current study out right now, a child diagnosed by an oncologist for hearing loss, and he doesn't see a psychiatrist for ADHD, and they diagnose with hearing loss, and he does have a hearing loss.
Yeah, and that is, I also think, why it's important to look into the underlying mechanisms. And this is just kind of one step, but there, I will be showing some more data on even going more in detail in terms of the pathways that may lead to difficulties in this area. We also know from the research that from an earlier study that we did across the boys and the adults with XXY, that those with more language problems did show more higher levels of autism symptoms. We also looked at another aspect of language, which is more has more to do with the coherence and logic in language. So we had speech samples of about 20-minute speech, and we coded all the words and all the coherence within that speech sample. So it's about the organization of your thoughts and speech, and about 40% of the children had difficulties with that. So it also refers to, noted that this reduced coherence in language was very much related to these executive and attention difficulties. So we know that executive functioning is also an important aspect of language in this group. So now moving on to social cognition. So that has to do with taking the perspective of another person and understand that other persons may have different thoughts and feelings and wishes and desires than you have. And to empathize, which is kind of emotionally resonate with others and share emotions. About half of the group had an average score, but also the half of the group had a score in the clinical range. I would also like to talk a little bit more about emotional responsiveness, and I'm moving more towards other type of studies that we did. because I got interested in emotions and what is an emotion? It has kind of a physical response to it. It has to do with feelings, which are more subjective, with thoughts in labeling what you feel, and also in emotional behaviors. So the physical response is very much automatic and often very subtle. So when hearing a baby cry, this is our queen when she got married, and maybe some were kind of being very macho about it, but would still show kind of changes in heart rate and changes in sweat production because they were actually moved by her crying. So these changes can be very subtle and you can record it, and I think these are really important indicators of kind of emotional reactivity. And in general, emotions are really helpful because they help navigate and help to make decisions and help to resonate with others. But kind of too little or too much emotion, that can cause some difficulty. So we decided to look a little bit closer to that. So eyes of others are considered kind of most of crucial aspects of faces, and we know that automatic orientation is something that we often see towards eyes of others when you talk to someone, or to follow gaze. If someone would look up there, it's very automatic to also check what is happening. So we know that looking at someone else's eyes is increases your emotional arousal, and that looking towards and away from eyes is a kind of means to help regulate your own emotional arousal. So we thought it would be interesting to look at patterns of visual attention away and towards eyes of others while measuring this kind of emotional arousal. So this is something that we were able to do in 17 adults with XXY as compared to a group of 20 controls. And what we did was we had the eye tracker to assess social attention. So what are you attending in your social, what are you attending to in your social environment? And at the same time record emotional arousal through skin conductance. And we also ask about labeling your own emotions and the emotions of the other. So that has to do with the understanding of emotion. So what we did was present various video clips, and this is something that Nicole included in the presentation this morning, where emotions were kind of highly visible, and we thought it would cause a kind of emotional response, and it did. Here you can see the kind of increase in responding from baseline versus whenever we presented this emotional movie clip. And we see that there's an increase in response in the control group. These are the dark bars. And in the gray group, it's for the adults with XXY. And what we actually noticed is that the emotional response was higher. So there was a kind of over-arousal in reaction to the emotions of others in this movie clip. And this actually kind of fits with the earlier findings that we had, that in the adults were more influenced by emotions in a decision-making test, and also kind of the reported high levels of distress during social interaction. Well, there's a kind of difference between, you can emotionally respond to someone, and that's good to have emotions triggered. And we often say that it's empathy if it's a kind of constructive towards the other. But if it's emotional, if you're overwhelmed by your emotions, that is more like personal distress, it's termed, it's labeled. And that is actually, in that case, it's more difficult to have attention for the emotions of others if you're overwhelmed by your own emotions. So it's a kind of, yeah. So it's not a, I would not say it's a kind of lack of empathy, but it's a lot of emotion, and it's more like emotional reactivity. And I think when looking at this graph, and it's about emotion understanding. Here we see that the dark bars are the data from the control group, the gray bars from the XXY group. We see that the group with XXI had some more difficulties with labeling the emotions of the characters in the movie clip, and also in terms of the correspondence of their own emotions and the emotions of the character in the movie clip, and also giving kind of empathic reasons for your own emotions. So in terms of understanding emotions, they had some more difficulties. And then at the same time, we looked at where they were looking at in the movie clips, and we defined all kinds of areas of interest. So were the participants looking at objects, or the body, or the eyes of the characters, or the mouth, the face, or other areas? And we found that the XXY group tended to fixate less on the eyes of the characters. Okay. So this is just to illustrate, Nicole showed this morning, that in the control group we do see that they were kind of fixating on the eyes and the mouth a lot, and in the XXY group it was more the mouth but less of the eyes. We also looked at emotional expressions, and we presented a series of faces just to be able to identify what people would look at first. So whenever you see a face, what are you looking at? So here we decided to evaluate if they were looking at the face as a whole, at the eyes or the mouth, or just on screen. And here are all these different areas of interest, and in light gray the scores of the control group, and in black the scores of the XXY group. And we noted when looking at, sorry?
You reverse the colors.
Yeah, I'm sorry, this is from another paper. I'm not so consistent. Yeah. So on average, the average looking time was lower for the eyes as compared to the control group. So they tend to spend kind of less time focusing on the eyes. And when we looked at where they fixate first, where individuals look first, we saw that what you expect kind of in the control group is that there's a preference. So in the light gray, you will see there's a preference for the eyes as compared to the other areas. But this preference was not there in the extra X group. They were looking less at the eyes and actually more at kind of other areas of the screen.
Have you guessed as to whether or not it might be because there's such intense emotions with looking at the eyes and yeah. So over-regulated yeah. That...
Well, that's a really good question, and we did have a look at it because... we had different intensities of emotion ranging from kind of 0% to 25% to 50% to 75% emotion, and it did not really matter what intensity we presented the faces. And also the type of emotion also did not matter a lot. So it's kind of initial automatic social orienting that is compromised, I think, before you actually see the intensity and see the emotion type. So it's a very automatic response. So there we came up with this idea about the emotion dysregulation hypothesis, that whenever you have kind of eye contact with other people and you have difficulties in understanding social signals, this might lead to kind of increased arousal because you have difficulty understanding but you're looking at them. And you might respond with kind of avoidance of looking at the eyes of others. But we know from the literature on emotion regulation that avoidance is not really a constructive strategy in managing your emotions. So it's a kind of insufficient downregulation of arousal, which might leave you still with anxiety and distress in social interactions. And this is may have relevance in the sense that this may reduce the social learning experiences that you have. And if you have less experience, social experience, you may also have kind of more difficulties in understanding social signals because you don't get to learn about them.
Don't you think this might have something also to do with that shy?
Well, the result could be shyness. Yeah. Yeah. But you're shy for a reason, right? You're just not shy. There's always a reason to be shy. And I think this is some kind of background mechanism that may result in shyness. Yeah. So I think that this kind of the difficulties in understanding social signals might be a real good target for intervention, because if you are able to help someone understand what you're seeing or what someone is kind of projecting or the messages they are conveying, it might actually help in getting less aroused or anxious, and this whole process would not be a kind of down spiral. Yeah. So now we've started new research, because I immediately got this question, do we also see this in young children, of course? So we have started doing that, and I also had this question, how does kind of reduced social attention may affect language development? Because you have to look at others to learn about the words, how things are called in the environment in young children, and can we stimulate social attention? So we are now starting with a longitudinal study in 1 to 6-year-olds with sex chromosome trisomies, where we look at these things, social attention, emotional arousal, cognitive and behavioral development, and where we also assess effects of interventions that are really targeted at emotion understanding. We just did a pilot study only in kind of typically developing children to see if it all works, but by the end of the year we'll be starting seeing participants.
My son had extremely good eye contact until a 3-vaccine reaction.
Until?
Until a 3-vaccine reaction.
Oh, really?
I would love to see more research done.
Yeah.
The environmental trigger to the genetic predisposition.
Yeah. Yeah, environment is really important because it's not only about genetics. Yeah. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. So when taken together, I think that the areas that we should be looking at is social cognition, language, executive attention, and emotion regulation in understanding of why some individuals may develop social problems. But then, I have this question that whenever there are social problems and understanding the cognitive functions that may contribute and understand the brain mechanisms that are involved in XXX and XXY, the question is to how does that compare to children with idiopathic autism. So what are the similarities and differences in cognitive functions? What are the similarities and differences in brain architecture? So that is something that we did take a look at, and this is really very recent work, comparing behavior, cognition, and brain development in idiopathic autism versus the sex chromosome trisomies. So we had this group of 60 boys or girls with an extra X and compared them to children with idiopathic autism to look for similarities and differences, and this is a work in progress, so we're not done, but I just wanted to share with you some of our preliminary findings. So for example, when looking at behavior, and this is about social anxiety, kind of different aspects of social anxiety in terms of social interactions, physical abilities, intellectual abilities, physical appearance, we noted that children with an extra X actually have more social anxiety than children with ASD, and I think it can be a difficulty for a child, but it can also be positive. But it does mean that there's kind of more concern about social relationships, and also more reflection on social situations, maybe more so than children with idiopathic autism. And it might help in thinking about how to help these children and how to be able to use this to improve social adaptation. And when we look at cognition, this is just one thing I took a look at in terms of the predictors of social cognition. So whenever there's difficulties in perspective taking, where do these difficulties originate from? And we found out that in the group with idiopathic autism, it was more about language skills and the processing of facial expressions that really contributed to difficulties in perspective taking. But in the extra X group, it was more the executive attention skills that predicted how they were able to take perspective of others. So there were kind of preliminary indication that there might be some differences in pathways, and that would mean that we should also think about other ways of stimulation or training or intervention for these groups. We also looked at brain architecture. This is the work of Marcia Brandenburg. She's a PhD student in my lab, and she, just a small group of children, 16 children with XXI, we just didn't have the money to include the girls with trisomy X or larger numbers, with 16 non-clinical controls and 16 children with ASD, and they were all age matched. So when looking at brain volumes, we focused on gray matter density. So we used a kind of automated voxel-based morphometry technique, and we focused on brain regions that we know are important for social behavior. So the superior temporal gyrus, which is not only important, the temporal is situated in the temporal lobe, is important for language, but this part is also important for focusing on eye gaze of others. The amygdala, that's kind of deep in the brain, is important for screening, for emotional relevance, for processing, facial expressions. The orbital frontal cortex is more in front of the brain, important for controlling emotions. The insular cortex, that's an area that has to do with monitoring of your bodily arousal or your emotions, monitoring of your emotions, your bodily state. And the medial prefrontal cortex in the brain, which we know is important for perspective taking and more higher order social cognition. So we looked at these brain areas and we first look at in what way was the group of boys with an extra X different from controls. And we found that there was kind of less gray matter in the insular cortex, which is important for the monitoring of your bodily state. Also reduced gray matter on average in the orbital frontal cortex. That has to do more with the regulation of your emotional state. And we also find some differences in the superior temporal gyrus, so important probably for language, but also for focusing on eye gaze of others. And then we compared the XXY group to the idiopathic autism group, and then we found that this gray matter difference in the insular cortex and the orbital frontal cortex was really typical for the Klinefelter group, because it differentiated the Klinefelter group from the autism group. It was not typical for the autism group, but very specifically found only in the boys with an extra X. Yeah. I should have included the percentage signal change, but it's all kind of more... That's difficult to say at this point, yeah. Maybe it's I could point it out more in the paper that will be the result, because that will convey all this type of information in more detail, yeah. We also looked at white matter connections. That is something that we did with looking at diffusion, using diffusion tensor imaging, DTI. So that is more about the connections between the brain areas, the white matter pathways. And when we looked at the Klinefelter boys versus the controls, the biggest difference that we saw was in the corpus callosum. So that is a big portion of white matter connecting the left and the right hemisphere. And it really is important for coordination of thought and behavior, coherent perception of the world, and efficiency of asymmetric brain functions like language, which is typically more left hemisphere mediated. So this was something that was found in the extra X group, but when we compared the white matter in the extra X group versus the children with idiopathic autism, we only find this really small spot here, which is part of the inferior frontal occipital fasciculus. It's actually... This was versus controls, the corpus callosum, and this is versus the XXY group versus the autism group. So this is kind of the longest bundle of white matter in the brain, connecting all the way back from the occipital lobe to the temporal lobe, to the parietal lobe, to the frontal lobe. And unfortunately, we don't know the exact function of this part of the brain, but it has been suggested it has a possible role in language networks and semantic processing. So that is something that would be interesting to look at as a kind of specific for the XXY group as compared to the children with idiopathic autism. So now moving on to functional MRI. We asked the children to do all kinds of tasks while inside the scanner. So we asked them to match objects, so find the object in the bottom that matches the above. So this is a coat, they select the coat. We also asked them to match facial expressions, so if this one would look angry, they had to select one of those who was also looking angry. And at the same, we also had some conditions where they had to verbally label what they were seeing. So here, these would be all coats, and these would be all angry. So we compared those contrasts in order to look at differences in brain activation during effect recognition and effect labeling. So we tease those apart. So when looking at effect recognition, in controls, we typically find frontal activation, amygdala activation, temporal activation, but we actually did not find any significant differences in our clinical group of children with autism and in a group of children with an extra X chromosome. But when looking at effect labeling, we found a kind of different findings in the XXY group as compared to the autism group, because in the XXY group we found a lot of frontal activation and a kind of increased frontal activation. So in order to be able to label the effect facial expressions, the frontal parts of the brain were working harder than controls and harder than the ASD group. And what we found in the ASD group was that they had increased activation in the amygdala. So actually, in order to be able to label affective faces, the amygdala was working harder. So this was kind of a different pattern. So taking together, there may be similarities in terms of social difficulties, but I do think there are also indications that may suggest there are some differences, kind of increased anxiety in the children with an extra X, which is not present in the children with autism, more face memory and language difficulties that contribute to social cognitive difficulties in autism versus executive functioning in the extra X group. And looking at the neural level, we see that's more amygdala deviations in autism versus more frontal and insular, so brain areas involved also in executive functioning and monitoring of your bodily state. So I do think that taking together, first let me kind of summarize all the findings that we have in terms of developmental vulnerabilities. I would say that taking all the data together, that social interactions may be challenging for some of the children and adults. There might be a preference for doing things in a particular way or order. There may be difficulty with expressing thought and emotion, or difficulties to see things from other people's perspective. No, not to say that these all need to be present, but it's just kind of screening list. There may be less automatic orienting to kind of crucial social cues in terms of the eyes of others. Some may be anxious or withdrawn in social situations and difficulties in managing friendships. There may be difficulties with controlling thought and behavior and emotion. So individuals may come across as kind of disorganized or impulsive, or there may be kind of emotional outbursts. Individuals may be easily distracted, meaning that making plans or organizing things may be a challenge. Or during conversations, children may have difficulties in taking turns, staying on topic, understand complex messages. And I think that in understanding the mechanisms behind that, it's really important that we think about all the things that are important in terms of the variety of cognitive functions. So here are our social behavioral problems. Here's just a variety of cognitive functions that are involved, all kind of brain areas that are involved, which are mediated by genetic risk. And there may be different pathways for different children, which show different patterns across groups. So there may be different pathways in autism spectrum disorder, idiopathic autism spectrum disorder, than in children with an extra X. So that really, for me, and now closing with some propositions that I have, I really think that neuropsychological assessment is necessary to address the question why children develop emotional behavioral problems. I think it's also important to, for the future, to compare kind of cognitive behavioral profiles in the boys and the girls, because we do have some data suggesting that it's quite comparable, but we really need more research on that. We also need to learn more about how environmental factors shape development, because genes don't determine completely how you will develop as an individual. There are lots of other genes and there are lots of environmental factors involved. And I also think we need to plan kind of systematic research strategies focusing on effectiveness of training and support. And I will talk about this a little bit tomorrow in evaluating a self-management training for adults. I think it's also important that we need to share the scientific knowledge with the kind of upcoming professionals. So try to include it in the educational curriculum in the area of mental health care. And we need to collaborate internationally to join forces, and we do. We have now been working with Nicole for a couple of years and with Carol Semengo-Sprau, so I think that's really important to work together. So I'd like to thank you for your attention, all the family and my collaborators.
So is your PowerPoint going to be available?
I will talk to the organization to make it available. Yeah.
Yeah.